If everyone could take a seat, we're about ready to begin, so please find a seat. All right, it's 6:30, the appointed time. We appreciate everyone being here. If you could all stand for the prayer and the pledge of allegiance, please. Mr. Dale Smart of the Dawson County Tea Party is going to lead us in a prayer. And it's a very special prayer.
Almighty God, whose great power and eternal wisdom embraces the universe, please watch over all our sheriffs and deputies. Protect them in their everyday duties of serving papers, traffic violations, evictions, domestic violence, and more. Give them the strength to accomplish the difficult tasks that lie before them. Give them the wisdom and quick reactions that will result in the safety of the people in their community and themselves. God, protect these brave men and women, grant them your almighty protection, and please unite them safely with their families after their duty has ended. Amen. Can you join?
Attention.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Please be seated. And the prayer that Mr. Smart read was the assurance prayer. And so that was why it was very appropriate. First, on behalf of the Dawson County Republican Party, I want to welcome you to the Sheriff's Forum. This is a very important event for our county and for all of its citizens, and so we appreciate you coming. I'm the chairman of the Dawson County Republican Party. Mr. Dale Smart is the chairman of the Dawson County Tea Party, and Heather Husselbus is the chairman of the Foothills Republican Women. And our three groups have combined for this forum. And I appreciate everyone being here. And we had a team that was involved in putting all this together. The team members consisted of Karen Armstrong, Sharon Keating, Pepper Pettit, Scott Yoakum, plus the ones we've already mentioned. And first, we want to express our appreciation to the Dawson County Board of Education for allowing us to use this beautiful facility. And we appreciate that very much. And in that regard, we really ask you to, if you brought anything in, to take it out with you or put it in the proper receptacles. And we also ask that you restrict your movements to the area immediately around the auditorium, the restrooms, or on this side. You should have passed them as you come in. And so we want you to respect the property as much as possible. And as has been mentioned in the public notices of this event, all questions to be asked were to be submitted by March the 12th. And all questions submitted by that time were carefully considered in our preparation of the questions that the moderators will be asking tonight. No questions will be taken from the floor. There'll be no exceptions. If you would now, I want you to reach into your pockets or your purses and pull out something that may look like this. And you know what I want you to do? It's very important. Either silence it so I can't feel the vibration, or just shut her down. And we need to make sure we honor that request, because we don't want to disturb any of the comments from our candidates tonight. And as a courtesy to all, any conversations need to be carried on outside the auditorium. And except for the introduction of the candidates, which I'll do very shortly, and please, this is very important, you need to hold your applause until the conclusion of the forum. Our time limit is very tight, and we're striving to give as much time as possible for all the candidates to answer the questions. I appreciate your passion and the names on the outfit. That is wonderful, but please think about all the candidates as we go through this process. There are time limits for the candidate responses to the questions, and these limits will be given by the moderators when the questions are asked. We do have timekeepers that will indicate to the candidates and the moderators time remaining for their answers. I want to introduce the moderator. Charlie Auberman is Executive Director of the Development Authority of Dawson County, as well as the Executive Director of the Industrial Building Authority of Dawson County and Chairman of the Joint Development Authority for Dawson, Lumpkin, and White Counties. And Charlie has been around the county longer than I have, and we certainly appreciate him being here. And another person who's been here quite a while is Dick Bergen. Dick is well known in Dawson County, having been the chairman of the Dawson County Planning Commission for 12 years until his recent retirement. And we appreciate the agreement of both of these men to serve as moderators. They've distinguished themselves as having the best interests of Dawson County and its residents in their hearts for many years, and we're pleased to have them moderate this forum. At this time, I want to introduce each candidate and ask their wives to stand when the candidate is recognized. First, alphabetically, is Jeff Johnson and his wife, Lisa. Next, and you can clap right now. Okay. Yeah. Jeff Perry and his wife, Lisa. Frank Sosebee and his wife, Sherry.
Go Sosebee!
Tony Wooten and his wife, Jennifer. Thank you very much. And now I'm going to turn it over to Charlie Alberman.
The candidates draw for the order has been done randomly. We're going to start with opening remarks. The first person will be Frank Sosebee. Then Jeff Perry, Jeff Johnson, and then Tony Wooten. Opening remarks to begin with. You have 2 minutes to offer your opening remarks at this time. Frank Sosebee's first.
I hope everybody can hear me. I am kind of loud, so big guy. I've got 32 years of law enforcement experience in all facets of law enforcement. Right now, I'm currently with the Georgia Department of Corrections at Hall County Correctional Institute, where I'm the chief of security there. And we're seeing 200 convicted felons. We send these guys out every day to work, about 160 of them. But not only that, I have an education that I'm fixing to graduate my bachelor's degree in 2 months. I've worked on this and I'm proud of it. I am gonna pursue my master's in public administration after that. That is a goal I've set for myself, whether I'm sheriff, whether I'm still at Hall County or wherever God has me. But I have executive training. I have management training. I have supervision. I'm actually a reconstructionist. I've worked in all areas from homicides, child molestations. I've done all this. There's nothing I haven't done. I want to be your sheriff. I've worked 32 years to be where I'm at tonight. And I feel that I am capable of being the next sheriff of Dawson County and leading this county and y'all citizens with y'all's help into the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Jeff Perry, and if you take anything away tonight about me, I'd like for you to remember these four things, and I call them my four C's. Number one, I'm a Christian. I stand on my faith. Second thing, I'm a constitutionalist. I believe in the Constitution. I believe it's more than just ink and a paper. You know, I look at it, I carry a book with me about the Declaration of Independence and the U.S. Constitution. Third, I'm conservative, and that's the way a fiscal conservative when it comes to fiscal responsibility. And then the fourth is common sense. You know, somewhere along the way, in the last 20 years, maybe further, we lost common sense in government. We need to get back to that. I'd like to share with you a few things about my background. My name, like I said, is Jeff Perry. I have a degree in criminal justice from Georgia Southern College. I'm completing a master's degree at the University of North Georgia. I completed a certified public manager's program at the Carl Benson Institute at the University of Georgia. Almost 30 years experience working in law enforcement. The last 18 as a chief parole officer, managing a district consisting of 7 counties and multiple staff. I set priorities, I set operational strategic plan, I directed operations, I managed the budget, and I managed people. And I made the tough decision that comes with those. So again, my name is Jeff Perry. I ask for your vote on May 24th. Visit us on our website, votejeffperryforsheriff.com. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming. It's my pleasure to be able to stand here and be a part of this process. There's a couple of things I'm going to share with you tonight. As I've lived in Dawson County for this will be my 32nd year. I met, married my high school sweetheart here. We raised two fine sons. One of them's here now. One of them's living in Troy, Alabama. I'm vested in this community. I have a desire to serve our community in a far greater capacity. For nearly 24 years, I've served in a true law enforcement capacity. Now, you're gonna hear folks talk about experience. And what I want you to leave from here tonight is realizing what your sheriff's office is comprised of, what duties and responsibility. You're tasked with electing your next sheriff. And first question that we need to ask ourselves is, what does that experience curtail? What does that position require? And I think it's very, very important that we need to educate ourselves as to what exactly your sheriff does. Are we electing a figurehead, or are we electing a sheriff, someone that's gonna roll his sleeves up and get in, go to work, basically? I grow tired of politicians that hold offices, and I assure you that I will not be one of those. I've worked patrol. I cut my teeth in the jail. I've had some good detention experience. I worked patrol for numerous years. I've supervised and served in investigations in special assignments. I served sometime in a multi-agency task force for a while. Ladies and gentlemen, your sheriff's office is a multifaceted organization. And ladies and gentlemen, I ask you today, tonight, to consider the experience that's required that goes along with this title. Ladies and gentlemen, I seek to serve you. I want to get involved as I get out and talk to folks. I hear their concerns. I see what they want. I hear their concerns about investigations, about being cared for. Ladies and gentlemen, I seek to serve in a far greater capacity. And as your sheriff, if you so elect me, I promise that I will be involved. Thank you.
All right, no matter what I do, I can't sit down. No matter what I do with last name W, I end up being last. I don't know how that works in life, but we always end up being last as W's. Yeah, Z's there for y'all. So, for me, you know, I'm Tony Wooten, by the way, in the sheriff's office. I've been here 18 years in the sheriff's office. I start my 19th year next month. You hear a lot of people talk about what they've done. You know, to me, you got to look at what, see the results of that, because too many times in elections, you hear promises, and you may hear those tonight with what I'm going to do. And I get tired of hearing those. Let's look at people's results and what they've done for the community. And that's what I feel like that we should be looking for as our next sheriff, is the person that's been out, that's been doing these things. People say that, I want to do this, I want to do that if I'm sheriff, but why haven't you been doing that for the last few years when you've been here? Why do we wait until the time? And I say this every election with the sheriff, every election with anything else that goes on. Every 4 years, somebody steps up and says, hey, by the way, Dawson County, I love you. This is who I am. I know you don't know me, but I love you. You should know the person. You should be able to see that this person's been dedicated to your community. And I feel like that I've been that. As far as experience, I've worked in every aspect. I started here in Dawson County 18, almost 19 years ago. I started in the jail. I worked my way to the top in several different divisions. I've been the division commander of every single division except for one in the sheriff's office. I think that's important. I believe on day one, when somebody takes over, they need to understand what the sheriff's office is. They need to understand day one how to take over the sheriff's office, how to run that sheriff's office. And I believe with my experience running your investigations and your patrol division and those things, I believe I have that experience. Again, I ask for your vote on May 24th. Thank you.
We have 9 questions prepared for each of the candidates. First question, you will have 90 seconds, a minute and 30 seconds to answer the question to move on. And that first question is, how do you think the community views the role of sheriff? Mr. Sosebee is first.
I think the sheriff, first and foremost, has to be a friend. I think it has to be somebody that comes in there, that reaches out to each individual in this county, from a small child to a senior citizen. Going out and seeing somebody, sitting in their living room and talking to them. We forgot where that came from, what that is. We forgot what it is that a sheriff is really supposed to be. He's supposed to be somebody that comes out and cares about everybody. It's not just about the law enforcement side of it. There is a part that has to be humbling. And it is humbling that you go in and you sit down with somebody that's got a concern, and you can help that individual, that lady, that man, that child, a kid in school. A sheriff is somebody that wants the best for his community, and that's what I want. I've worked, like I said, for 32 years preparing myself for this. I've got a lot of friends in this county. I've got a lot of family in this county. I do have grassroots in this county. I know what it's like to sit on top of a mule my grandpa plowed field with. I've been there. I can roll my sleeves up and work just as hard as anybody else. I believe in that. It's being in there working with your employees side by side every day. It's not sitting in an office. It's being down there with them, showing that you do care about them. It's leadership. That's what it means. Thank you.
Thank you. I started out sitting down, but everybody started standing up, so I think the question, I believe in community policing. In my 30 years in law enforcement, that's what we did. We worked with community. What data shows us, community wants five things. They want to be free from crime. They want the offender to be held accountable. They want transparency in government. And they want treatment for the offender if he gets in there. And then the fifth and final thing is that they want to be involved in the process. And that's what data shows us. It's not what we do in law enforcement, not what we do to the community or for the community, but it's what we do with the community. And as your sheriff, we will enhance and support the community policing program, in which I have a strong background in that. You can go on my website and see where I put together a format for community policing. So I ask you to go look at that. But those are the five things that data has shown us that the community wants. They want to be in a partnership with law enforcement. And so as your sheriff, that's what we will do. We enhance community policing program, and we will work in a community partnership with you, the community. Thank you.
Mr. Johnson.
I think it's important where you're at in our country, how the sheriff is viewed. I think here your sheriff is viewed as a community protector. And I agree with that. And I think the sheriff needs to be open. He needs to be available to his community members. I think if they have an issue or problem, they need to be able to come to the sheriff. They need to be able to talk to him. But I also submit to you that I also believe that today's role, the sheriff needs to be a far greater than a community protector. We see what happened recently in Brussels. We see what's happening in California, the school shootings, the roadside shootings, things of that nature. Dawson County, we're approaching a new age. And if we think for a moment that it won't happen here in Dawson County, we're naive. And I submit to you that we need a sheriff that's going to be prepared, that's going to prepare his people for times such as that. Do I believe in community policing? You better believe it. I believe if our folks know you on a personal level, they're going to be more inclined to take better care of you. But I also believe that we need to prepare our folks for the future and for what's coming inevitably. Because, ladies and gentlemen, as sad as it is to say, Dawson County is not what it used to be. We have soft targets here in Dawson County. We know that. We realize that. We see the mall. What better place for an act of terrorism to occur? In Dawson County, I think we need to get serious. We need to start thinking ahead. We need to start get outside the box and stop thinking locally and start thinking on a national level as well. Thank you.
Mr.
Wooten.
I think the sheriff is obviously a leader, somebody that's a leader in your community, somebody that you know, somebody that you can trust.
I don't take that word lightly, trust. I think that's something that you got to be able to do. You got to be able to trust the person that's going to be your sheriff. Everybody's got good answers up here as far as this. I mean, you know, I mean, Jeff's right, the fact that there's going to be, we have soft targets in Dawson County. We've been protecting those for years. I think every time you have a debate like this, you have people come out and start saying what they want to change about Dawson County, what they want to make better. You hear buzzwords like community policing that sadly haven't even gotten, people don't really understand what community policing is in a lot of people's aspects. They just say the buzzword because it's election time. I feel like the sheriff's office has done a good job. I feel like we live in a pretty safe community. Are we perfect? Absolutely not. We should strive every day to be better than we have been the day before. But we have a good sheriff's office. For the most part in here, most of us have never been victims of any violent crime. We don't have a lot of stuff that goes on in Dawson County. I want to keep it that way. The things we've done have been proactive that we've done in the past. I reduced crime when I was the patrol division commander and investigations commander. I reduced burglaries to a low that's almost half of what counties, some of the counties that surround us are. And I'm talking about counties that are the same size, not the bigger ones. So we can do this by simply keep doing what we're doing and enhancing the programs that we've already got. I've already mentioned that I want to do a retail unit out there in 400. That's where our greatest issue is. In the last debate, somebody said that we shouldn't put more resources out there. In this debate, you just heard that we should put that soft target out there. So we got to keep doing the things that we've been doing, and we got to pay attention to where our soft targets are. We got to have the resources and the experience of somebody that knows what to do to stop crime. I've done it once. I'll continue to do it.
The next question, and we'll start with Mr. Perry. What do you feel are the two most challenging issues to safety and security to the citizens of Dawson County, and how will you address them? Mr. Perry.
Thank you, Charlie.
I'm sorry, you got 2 minutes.
Okay, thank you. Two of the most, I'm sorry, what was that question again?
What do you feel are the two
most challenging issues to safety and security to the citizens of Dawson County, and how will you address them?
Okay, I think number one, drugs is a huge problem right now. You've seen they're having a drug summit in Atlanta, Georgia right now, where the president's coming to speak about that. And also, if you notice that we're starting to see heroin make its way back to Georgia and into the mainstream again. When they started cracking down on these pill doctors and prescription doctors who wrote countless numbers of prescriptions, people started looking for a different alternative, and that was heroin. You can get it cheaper, and it lasts a certain, it lasts almost the same amount of time as the substance and prescription medication. I think the other thing when we look at with the economic impact and economic growth coming to Dawson County, we need to be prepared in two things. And like I said, I've spoken about this using a formula called DDACS, and that's a data-driven approach to crime and traffic safety, where we utilize, we look at our 6-month rolling, 12-month rolling, and 1-month rolling, and we commit our resources to where the crime is. You know, we can't keep doing the things we used to do, because if you do, you're going to keep getting the same results. And I think if we concentrate down here. The third thing is by opening up and staffing the precinct down on the 400 corridor, because we have almost 72% of our tax revenue coming from that 400 corridor, yet most of our law enforcement is up here in the city. So we have looked to staff that to make it easier for the citizens to come get an accident report, an incident report, or things of that nature. Thank you.
Mr. Johnson.
When we talk about two of the most critical safety and security threats to our people, it's important that we want them, that we not only define what they are, and in my opinion, I do believe that drugs are a huge problem in Dawson County, because they are the catalyst of all other crimes, thefts and robberies and burglaries and murders and things of that nature. So number one, we have to get a good grasp on it. But two, we have to think collectively, what are our other issues and what are other problems? What are you most likely to be confronted with over the years? And you know, that can be a wide variety of things. We're starting now to see a lot of thefts, a lot of frauds coming into play. A lot of you may have been a victim of an attempted fraud. Those are things like that that we have to get a good grasp on in Dawson County. So how do we do that? How do we fix that? Number one, is your sheriff allowed me to wage the war on drugs? But then again, that's not a single person. There's not a one of us up here that can say that we're going to fix this or we're going to fix that. You know, only by the grace of God we're allowed to draw the last breath that we did. So we have to approach this thing realistically. Now, I believe it's a partnership. I believe that's where we get in partnership with our community. We start building that trust again. We start holding open forums. We start having community forums. We start having training. And we educate our public as to what we need to do to protect ourselves. We talk about issues. We talk about problems. We talk about active shooters and things like that. Ladies and gentlemen, if any one of you in here tonight in the sound of my voice are putting all your trust in one man, I feel sorry for you. Because, you know, ultimately, we have a hard enough time taking care of ourselves. But that's where we have to take our resources and we have to take our capabilities and help educate our public, help educate those to make the right decisions, to look, to listen, to be vigilant, to be cognizant of what's going on around you. And ladies and gentlemen, as your sheriff, if you so choose, that'll be one of the primary things that we do. We want to empower our people. In this day of independence, in this day of entitlement, I think we need to get our independence back and our autonomy back. And that'll be a focus and a direction of mine. Thank you.
Mr. Wooten.
Okay, two biggest issues. First for me, crime is crime. Whether you talk about traffic, whether you talk about burglaries, crime is crime because it makes you a victim. One of the things that I want to see the U.S. respond with is a traffic unit. It's been a long time since Dawson County's had a traffic unit, and it's the thing that we need to work on now. We had 14 fatalities last year in Dawson County. That's too many. Several of those were caused by drugs and alcohol. That's too many. The biggest chance that you have to probably get hurt by crime in Dawson County is traffic related, by people that aren't paying attention when they're driving or they're impaired driving. We've got to get a grasp on that. 400's coming up and it's coming quickly. The interchange is changing out there. We cannot afford to sit back on our hands and not do that. In an earlier debate, people said that they were going to turn it over to the state patrol. Sometimes you have one trooper covering three counties. We cannot, listen to me, cannot turn our problems over to other jurisdictions. You need a sheriff that will stand up here and handle those problems head on, not pass the buck to somebody else. We can't do that. They don't have the resources, and we can't ask them to be our sheriff. We need to have a sheriff that will handle that. The second thing is to continue to build the community trust. Dawson County has that. That's why I've stayed here 18 years. I haven't been anywhere else. I haven't come from anywhere else. I chose to be a part of this community, and we've got to continue to build that trust. We got people moving in. We've got to invite them into Dawson County. I can remember a time in Dawson County that either you were from here or you were moved in. And that is somewhat merged now, and I want to continue to see it merge, because we got a lot of good people that are from here. We got a lot of good people that have moved in. And we need to work together as a community to make this the safest place that we can live. I've got three kids at home. It's imperative to me to see us be able to do everything we can as a community. Our schools have to be safe. Crime has to be addressed at every single level. We can't do it monthly, can't do it every 6 months. Has to be done daily. You have to look at things daily to see what's going on with your crime and how to stop it on a day-to-day basis. I love when people say we want to use the same thing to get the same results. Our results have been phenomenal. We had 72 burglaries 3 years ago. That's lower than it was when I started in 1998. We've been at the part where we've had 150. Thank you.
Mr. Sosebee.
What we're facing right now is growth in this county. 400, everybody's seeing what's going on out there. We're going to have to prepare ourselves for what's coming. I prepared myself by going domestic terrorism training. I prepared myself going to gang investigations. I prepared myself for this position. We're going to have to go in and help our kids. Our kids need to be educated on what's going on around them. If you'll see a kid now, watch this, if you see a tattoo or something on their hands or on their arms, or maybe right here, they've been talked to about a gang. It's in this county. A lot of people don't believe that, but it is in this county. It may not be as prevalent as it is in Hall County where I'm at, because we do have some serious gangs in Hall County. Other things that I want to look at is a drug suppression unit. We're going to focus with Sheriff Gerald Couch, as we are in the same judicial circuit together. We're in the same court system. He and I are going to join together, and we're going to have a drug suppression unit that's going to fight crime in both counties. Last year alone, his county seized over $7 million. I think his county might have a little bit of that money. I know I would. So that's what we're going to focus on. I'm going to focus on a criminal apprehension suppression unit, where we work with all other related counties around here, all the sheriffs, and the criminal investigation units, where we can actually sit down and talk to them one-on-one, and we can find out who is doing the sting. We have a burglar here in this county, maybe this a person, they just had one in Lumpkin County. They can pattern this, they can put it together, and you'll see we can solve crimes this way. Another thing is you gotta look at is the senior citizens in this county. I'm gonna have a senior citizens academy. We're gonna teach them about scams. We're going to give them something that they're going to take with them, give them a bag that's going to be a survival kit, basically. It has all the necessities that can take care of them if something does happen. But I do have more. Thank you.
Question number three is also a two-minute question. What are your top three priorities as sheriff, and how would you achieve them? To go first, Mr. Johnson.
Top three priorities, number one, is our drug enforcement. We've got to do a better job. We've got to do a more thorough job. We have a wealth of resources at our fingertips. We need to make a better, we need to do a better job of using those resources. In our jail alone, we have so many avenues, first to link individuals, first to monitor for conversations, things like that. And it is a wealth of information. Ladies and gentlemen, I told you earlier, that's the catalyst of most other crimes. So we have to deal with that. If we're going to reduce our exposure to other areas, we have to increase our drug enforcement efforts. That's number one. Number two, I want the officers back in your neighborhoods. We talk about creating traffic enforcement units, things of that nature. Ladies and gentlemen, I've been in contact with GSP, but GSP is more than welcome and willing to come up here and assist with our traffic enforcement. I'm not saying we push aside from the table off yet, but I'm saying that I'm more concerned about your families, about your home, about your personal safety than I am the roadways. I'm not saying we're going to turn a blind eye to our roadways, but we can't be reactive. We don't want our roadways to turn into raceways. We don't want them to turn into speedways. We don't want them to turn into fatalities. But our patrol officers can do a thorough and a fine job going from residence to residence, also enforcing the law. The third thing, we need to do some restructuring of our internal processes. Ladies and gentlemen, for too long, we focused on the wrong thing. We're focusing on quantity and not quality. And that's where a lot of our problem is. We've got to focus on quality. Ladies and gentlemen, if it doesn't have substance, if it doesn't have merit, we won't do it. I don't care about statistics. I've never been a statistic person. I've worked at agencies where, you know, we want to talk about business checks. We want to talk about residence checks. Right through a residence, 30 miles an hour is not a residence check, I'm sorry to say. So don't tell me anything about statistics. I know how statistics can be padded. Ladies and gentlemen, if it doesn't have substance, if it doesn't have merit, we simply will not be done. Thank you.
Mr. Wooten?
Three things.
First, obviously, crime. That's a passion of mine. I'm going to continue to say it over and over and over. I'm going to talk about that. Saying that things don't happen the right way, the statistics. Our burglary rate went down 36% in 3 years. 36%. That didn't happen by cars driving 30 miles an hour not paying attention. That happened from hardworking men and women going out there every day, doing everything they can to reduce our crime in Dawson County. These guys don't need to be shorthanded or cheated that have worked every day in the Dawson County Sheriff's Office to try to reduce that crime. And I'm not gonna stand here and let that happen either. You know, say that we wanna be in your communities. My plan is the plan that puts officers in the communities. By saying you're gonna have a traffic unit and have retail prevention unit that I'm gonna have out there, I'm using the existing resources that we already have at the Sheriff's Office. They're not in the patrol division, not from investigations. I'm putting additional officers in the street. When those officers that are traffic enforcement are working traffic, and those people that are working retail are working retail, it frees up the officers that are on the shift to be back in your communities. But they can't be in your communities if we don't do something to add additional help out there, because they've got to respond to the calls that they get. We can be like Call County, some of those in the past that I grew up in, that they run from call to call. You can't prevent anything because you're going from call to call. We can't be that way. We have to get ahead of it. Drugs is obviously a big concern for everybody. Every agency, every county, every city, that's a huge concern for us, all of us. We've got to make sure we do a better job of that, better than we've even been doing. We've had a good drug unit. They've been very productive over the years, and we just need to continue to improve on that. The last thing is money for employees. I'm not asking for a tax increase. Let me say that a million times. We have 108 employees. I believe we have enough 108 employees. That's enough for the sheriff's office right now. I spoke again this week to the sheriff. I spoke to several people running for commissioner, and I'm going to make it clear over and over and over as a conservative until I feel like we've used all 108 positions the best way we can and did everything we can to fund those 108 positions. I don't need 128 positions if we're having to hire a bunch of idiots just to put them out there. That's gonna be people that y'all are mad at because they're not doing their job right. I wanna take care. Less is more sometimes. Thank you.
Mr. Sosebee.
The retention of employees is critical in Dawson County. They've lost so many. Over 80 employees, we can't do that. That's why I think a leader needs to step in and work side by side with these men and women and show that they care. By doing so, these employees, they won't leave for money, but they will stay and work side by side with somebody that does care. And I do care. I've been there. I know how it is to start from the jail all the way up to where I'm at now. Another thing is drugs in this county. Drugs in this county is ridiculous. We are going to enforce severe penalties against the drug dealer in this county. You've got my word on that. I'm going after the drug dealers. I'm not going after the dime, nickel, and penny people that just sells these dime bags of marijuana. That's not what we're after. We're after the ones that's running through this county. When I've got inmates, when I worked in this jail down here, it was telling me 100 pounds of marijuana would go through the county, 100 pounds of meth would go through this county, nobody does anything about it, that's a problem. I'm gonna put a stop to that. Or I'm gonna do everything I can in my power to put a stop to it, working with another county, the Sheriff County. Another thing is stopping the crime that's gonna be coming into this county. We've gotta focus on, it's not gonna be just at the outlet malls, it's gonna start at the outlet malls, it's gonna come into our neighborhoods. And that's where it's going to take extra patrols to come into these neighborhoods on this community policing project, on people working together. Officers need to be driving down the road. If they see somebody standing in a driveway, why can't they get out and just say, hey, introduce yourself. Let them know who they are. Let them know who's working that beat right there. We just forgot where we've come from. But we're going to get back to reality if I'm elected sheriff. Thank you.
Mr. Perry.
Thank you. Top three items, I think that was the question. Number one, we're going to look at staffing shortages. right? Since fiscal year 2013 to 2017 in the county's triennial budget, now they have authorized 109 positions for the Sheriff's Department without taking into account a 3% in the economic growth. So we're going to look at staffing shortages. When you have a patrol in the day, when you have five people on patrol, and then you got court, and you have people on leave, and that's going, then you have a felony stop that takes two people, at least two people, you're down to one person in the county. So we're going to look at that. The second thing is retention and recruitment. And with that, there's three things that comes within that. Money for the employees. Now, if you go back, our budget right now, between FY 2010 and 2015, is $600,000 plus, less than it was in 2010, again, with a 3% population growth. Okay, and then the third, when we look at the employees here, we have to think ways, smarter ways, work smarter, not harder, how we're going to retain these employees. It's not always about the money, but money goes a long way. And over the last 5 years, they lost 86 employees, and they're not losing them to Gilmer, Pickens, and Bannon. They're losing them to Johns Creek. So we're going to look at getting the pay up to where it's competitive around these other counties, Hall County, Forsyth County. And then going back, the last thing is continue with a partnership with the community. When I was in LOJ Cherokee, I worked with the fire department, I worked with EMS, and we would sit down with the state agency, GBI, and the federal agency, FBI. We would have intelligence briefings. And so what that does, everybody shared intelligence. That's one of the first things in reducing and fighting crime as a deterrent. So we all came in there, we shared information, we're gonna continue with that. We're gonna work with the fire department, we're gonna work with EMS, we're gonna work with state, and we're gonna work with federal.
Question number four is also a 2-minute question. Please prioritize the needs of the Sheriff's Department as you see them, and how will you address each need? 2 minutes, Mr. Wooten.
Say top four.
Please prioritize the needs of the Sheriff's Department as you see them, and how will you address each question?
Okay. I'm going to continue to say basically the same thing we've just said. It's probably going to be a lot of the stuff that you hear on this one too, the top priorities, and some of the stuff is right. I mean, we lose people in and out of jail quite a bit. I mean, that's, you know, I'm not trying to knock Jeff Johnson on that end. It's a training ground for officers to come into the jail. They start out. Some people like law enforcement, some people don't. We live in a society right now where, I mean, cops are being just ridiculed daily. If you don't believe me, ask me. I was on the news just a week or so ago. So I understand what it's like to be in that situation. So we have people that don't want to be in law enforcement anymore. We've got to change that as a community, as a society. That's got to be one of the top things that's got to be done. We're not just losing people because they're going to find other jobs. By the way, I don't know anybody that's went to Johns Creek. I'd like to hear the name of that person. I've been here 18 years, and the only one that almost applied to Johns Creek that I know of was me a long time ago. So we've lost people to different counties, and yeah, we just lost a few that are friends of mine. One that just went to a private sector job that's making about twice what he was here. How do you stop that? I mean, we're not going to be able to pay twice as much, y'all. This happens in business every day. Businesses don't continue to pay like they do. They don't. You can't do that every time. Thank you. I'm not through. Sorry. I'm just thanking you because she stepped up. The biggest priority, though, I still think we have to get ahead of the growth. The growth is coming. I've seen it during my time. When I first started here, I didn't even know Dawson County was a county when I drove through it the first time because there was nothing here. I mean, there was just nothing. 400 was a drag strip, from what I understand, years and years ago, as a road that led to nowhere, according to a lot of people. But we got to get ahead of that growth, and I've been a part of that growth. I've seen what we can do as a sheriff's office. I've seen what we've done already as a sheriff's office to prevent the crime that's going on now, that's went on before, because we've had worked hard. You hear everybody up on the stage say one of the top things they want to do is reduce crime. I appreciate that, because I have done that, along with the men and women that work here. We've done that. Can you imagine trying to stop less than 6 burglaries a month countywide? That's almost impossible to be everywhere. But we've done it to where 6 a month. And we got to continue to work hard, continue to work with our commissioners to try to fix the fact that, like I said earlier, we got to try to pay our people a little bit more money. We got to try to keep them. Thank you.
Mr. Sosebee.
It is correct. It's the retention of our employees. That's going to be critical. And what we're going to have to do, we're going to have to come in here, we're going to have to look at every employee, what their positions are, and see how top heavy the sheriff's office is. If you will look at it, the sheriff's office right now is very top-heavy. So what I plan on doing is I'm going to come in, I'm going to reorganize the department, I'm going to restructure it, and I'm going to put people in positions for the needs of this county. And it's going to save a lot of money during this restructuring. And with that money, I am going to give raises to these employees. They deserve it. Another thing that I want to do is we're going to look at the drugs again. I keep harping on that. That is a problem that we're going to have to deal with. Last week, we got 6 pounds of heroin out of a mini storage in Gainesville. It's here. It's right next door. That's only 20-something miles from here where that happened. Another thing is on this crime, on the criminal part of the crime, where the criminals are going to be coming into the homes. We've got to prevent this, ladies and gentlemen. We got to have officers in these neighborhoods. We got to have officers down on the street, not at 400, not 3 cars at exact speeds. They need to be in the neighborhoods, and I truly believe in that. Another thing is we're going to have to focus on traffic control out here, traffic enforcement. That was my expertise when I was coming up. Traffic fatalities, if you don't get a hold on this, will increase, and it could be any of our families. Some of us probably have had fatalities in our families before. So that is my expertise, and I am going to work on the traffic enforcement. Another thing I want to work on, we don't need to be chasing cars out here, the high-speed pursuits. I'll be honest right now, I'm going to stop that. We're going to have a no-chase policy in this county, unless it's a murderer, armed robber, child molester, some kind of fleeing felon. We got to stop this. Thank y'all.
Mr. Perry.
Again, I spoke on one of the first items, and it's still going to be crucial. It's going to be critical. It's a two-part. One is the staffing shortage at Dawson County Sheriff's Department. And I went over that. If you go and speak with some of the employees, and you got 109 people budget, you got 5 people on patrol, and then you take into account for court, felony stops, people being on leave, you're running around here with undermanned force in the county. And going back to retention and recruitment, right? We can pay more, but you're not going to enjoy it if you still have to work, you know, more hours just to, you know, because you're overcoming the staffing shortage. So that's a two-part question. The other thing, I come in with no ties to the sheriff's department. Work with numerous sheriff's department. I'm not indebted to anyone in the community with one goal, and that's we're going to put the best people in the right positions and have a strong leadership. And the leadership's going to be not from top to bottom, but from bottom to top. 3 things that we're going to do when we come in. We're going to form process action teams with the sheriff's department where everybody has a say. You know, not just patrol, not just CID, but the administrative assistants, the support staff. We're going to look at 3 things. What are we doing that we need to keep doing? What are we doing that we need to stop doing? And what are we not doing that we need to be doing? So when you lead from the top down, no one feels they have a buy-in. So we're going to form the process action teams. We're going to look at what needs to be changed. We're going to look at retention and recruitment. We're going to tap into North Georgia College, which has an excellent internship program. Now when people graduate from North Georgia College with a criminal justice degree, they graduate also with post-mandate, which saves the county by $8,000.
Mr. Johnson.
The priority and the needs of the county are direct, or the sheriff's office are directly the needs of the people. And the reason I say that is simply this, is that what affects us in the sheriff's office ultimately affects the people in our county. And that's where we have to be very, very careful. Obviously, there is a staffing issue. You know, first to say we're going to create this division, we're going to create this and create that. The latest staffing study showed the department to be about 40 officers short. And so I'm not sure where all these different positions are going to come from. But I'll say this, we need to make absolute use of the officers that we do have there. Now, how do we retain officers? One, I think it's through leadership. I think it's through inspired leadership. And again, how do we change that? It's a different day and age. We come, and now it's a society of where I wanted it yesterday, where we grew up, our mom and dad grew up, that we knew that we didn't earn things. You know, we might have got a new car when we were in our 40s or in our 50s, you know, and so the mentality's changed. But I'm not saying that the mentality is lost. I think we need to do a better job of focusing back and strengthening our recruitment, strengthening our application process. We need to find folks that are truly, absolutely suited for public service, because it is a commitment. It's tough. Jeff Perry said it a while ago. When an officer has to go to court, when they get called in to do this, when they have a death or duty, our staffing is short. Our staffing is in need. It stays in need. But I think we can do a better job with what we do have. I do believe in employee retention. So how do we retain employees? Is your sheriff. I will remain involved in sheriff. I'm not going to be a disconnected sheriff. I've devoted too many years to investigations. And when I say experience, I encourage you to verify people's experience. Don't sit up here and let me tell you that I've done this and I've done that. Verify the information. I've served for years in investigations. I will stay active with your investigations. I will stay active with your patrol department. I think that we have a wealth, but it's got to be one of those situations where we lead by example. And as your sheriff, I promise you that I will stay involved and I will stay in with our folks. Thank you.
Okay, question number five. This is another 2-minute question. I'll read it twice because it's a little lengthy. A bill under consideration in the Georgia Legislature would require an individual receive a criminal conviction before civil forfeiture action results in the liquidation of seized property. Do you support this bill? And I'll repeat that. A bill under consideration in the Georgia Legislature would require an individual receive a criminal conviction prior to or before civil forfeiture action results in the liquidation of seized property. Explain your position. Mr. Sosebee.
Thanks, sir. I'll answer yes on that. Reason I'm answering yes on that, if they go to court and they're found not guilty, what can we seize then? They're going to turn right back around, we're going to give it right back to them. So I think anytime we seize any assets, that we need to work closely with our district attorney's office and file the proper paperwork to seize these assets, and then utilize those once the criminal trial is over with, he's found guilty or he pleads out one way or the other. And we utilize these funds however we need to. It's just like with drug trafficking, drugs. If we seize drugs, we're going to seize houses, we're going to seize cars. And there's a process that this has to go through. And once it's clear we can seize this, we can sell this on government auctions. You can make a lot of money through that web page. But yes, we will wait till the trial is over with. Thank you.
Mr. Perry.
Thank you. I agree with, I think we should support this bill. And I still believe in a country where a person is innocent until proven guilty. That's the concept of our baseless criminal justice system. So if we start convicting someone before they go to court and taking their assets, asset forfeiture, we've seen a lot of people when there was a threatened ban on firearms several years ago, it was a great business for gun owners and gun shops. And they would have large amounts of money. There's a gun shop in Athens, Georgia. And they would take, and anytime you deposit over $100,000 in cash, then you know you have to file something. The bank has to notify the federal government. And if you don't think the federal government makes mistakes, look at the 1996 Olympics and Richard Jewell. I was fortunate to be a part of that Olympics as part of the State Olympic Law Enforcement Command. And that goes back again where a person is innocent until proven guilty. This story in Athens, Georgia, the feds went in to do an asset forfeiture, and they confiscated the $100,000. To this day, he spent over $100,000 with lawyer fees trying to get that money back that's rightfully his, that he committed no crime, and he still hasn't got that money back. So yes, I support that wholeheartedly. That, you know, we cannot start asset forfeiture proceedings until a person is actually found guilty.
Mr. Johnson.
And I concur. There's no room for debate, in my opinion, on this matter. We have to make sure, first of all, we need to also understand that your sheriff's office is not a revenue-generating entity. It's a service. It's a public service. And I think we need to be careful. We need to draw a fine line when we're approaching things like that. Do I believe in seizures? Absolutely I do. But also, again, I believe in the court system. And again, your sheriff's office is a is a post-adjudication. Your sheriff is concerned with enforcing the laws and the services of Dawson County. You know, we're not concerned with innocent or guilt. We're concerned, that's the court's job. That's the jury's and the court's decision is to decide if someone's innocent or guilt. Your sheriff's job is to enforce the laws, to enforce them fairly and enforce them impartially. As your sheriff, I agree with this and I concur with this, that we do not need to seize anything until that person is found guilty in the eyes of the court, and then we can move forward with the proceedings. Thank you.
Mr. Wooten.
I love standing on my own because I'm going to disagree wholeheartedly with all three of you. When we've done asset forfeitures, you keep saying the court system. We have a court system for asset forfeitures now. We don't just walk in and say, thank you for your stuff. We have, there's a system in place already. If you go back and start saying, we're going to wait until we convict people in this room that know how the court system works, that could take years. So what are we going to do? I want some money from some of you that are going to be commissioners, because if I win, we're going to need storage facilities for these things for years. We're going to be places for the depreciation of these cars and houses that aren't going to be worth anything by the time they actually get through court to be found guilty. There's already a program in place. It's already there. We already have asset forfeiture rules that we follow now. It goes to the court system. They can fight that then. You don't have to wait until somebody's been found guilty for asset forfeitures. You're going to give a green light for the drug dealers. They're going to love that bill when that passes, by the way. They're going to be excited about the fact that they're not going to have to worry about losing their stuff right off the bat. And what is the sheriff's office going to do? I hate to put birds out of business, but I guess we're going to have to open a storage facility for the sheriff's office because we're not going to be able to do anything with our stuff. We're going to have to house it forever. I don't know how else to say that we cannot change that law. I hope that you fight that tooth and nail. I mean, it's just crazy for me to walk in, do drug deals that we've done. We've got recorded lines with people saying that they've sold drugs and that's how they've gotten the money that they've gotten done things with. And we're going to tell them, you get a pass for 2 years. I guess sometimes I believe maybe I'm too conservative, but I believe you got to punish the people that do stuff like this. We can't say we're going to sit back and wait for you to be found guilty. There's a process in place. It goes to the court system right now, and we need to continue to follow that process. We can't be a holding facility. We cannot be a place that sits back and worries about the depreciation. I mean, these drug dealers are smart now. They drive, sometimes the cars are a piece of junk now because if they get caught, they don't want to have to lose anything. By the time we get it, we'll have to push it out of the parking lot. So we'll be, I don't know what we're going to do with any of this stuff. It won't be worth anything. Drug dealers are going to love us if we pass that bill. I totally disagree with it. Sorry if I'm wrong, but I'm going to go to the grave on that one. We cannot continue to reward criminals in this country.
Okay, question number 6 has a number of parts to it, and I've been asked to let the audience know that each of the candidates received some information that was provided to them to review in preparation for this next question. And then the question to all 4 of the candidates, were you able to review the information provided regarding Sheriff Richard Mack's position? Mr. Sosebee?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Perry?
Yes.
Mr. Wooten?
Yes.
Okay, so everyone received the information and had an opportunity to review that. The first part of the question then is the information that was provided by Sheriff Richard Mack, what stood out the most to you? And you've got a minute and a half to address that. What stood out the most to you, Mr. Perry?
Let me just try to do a little background on this for you. Some of you don't know. Sheriff Richard Mack, he was the sheriff in, I believe, Graham County, Arizona. And while there, he was a very pro constitutionalist, believed in the Constitution wholeheartedly, and the NRA used him to file a lawsuit against it was Mack v. Arizona, but it bordered on the Brady Bill. That certain aspects of it violated the Second Amendment. Now, if you go back and you look at anything I said or anything that I've done, I support the Second Amendment. And I said this over and over, and you go back and read what I said, I would not support any federal authorities to come in here to try to submit to Dawson County and try to arrest someone on, which is enforce an unconstitutional law, which is the Second Amendment. And that's what Sheriff Mack wrote about. And he said, he wrote a book, it's a pamphlet actually, he said,
He said, and the title of the book is Sheriffs, America's Last Great Hope, meaning that the sheriff is really the highest office in the county, and they have the authority to resist anything that's unconstitutional, be it federal or state. They're sworn to uphold the federal U.S. Constitution. They're sworn to uphold the state constitution and state law. And so that's what Sheriff Richard Mack is. He's very supportive, a constitutionist, which I say I am a constitution. I believe in the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution and the Bill of Rights.
Thank you. Mr. Johnson, what stood out to you?
In Prince versus U.S., in Prince versus United States, what we have is they challenged a portion of the Brady Bill, basically, requiring them or forcing them to do certain background checks, and so they were victorious in that. One thing I believe in, and I'm a steadfast pro-amendment period. I don't care which amendment it is, but especially the Second Amendment. I believe so many men and women died for that right. And as your sheriff, and we constantly, and we still, we've held classes, you know, informing and educating our public as to what they can carry, when they can't carry. And, you know, if you ask me my personal opinion, I'll certainly give it to you. I think there's too many laws on the books regarding our firearm carry right now. But that's neither here nor there. We can only affect what we can. As your sheriff, and what came out about this court case, too, is that they want to argue, and again, there's two sides to the equation. And basically, it's put as the sheriff is the supreme law in the county, and he's the chief law enforcement officer of the county. However, some people on the other side will debate. You know, I believe it's Article 6 of the Constitution said that that they'll uphold federal law. So again, that's a debatable issue. But I say this, as your sheriff, I assure you that I fully stand in support of our Second Amendment rights, as I do all of our amendment rights. We've made too much progress. We've come too far. To let a next sheriff come in and take those from you. We need to continually be teaching our people, empowering our people, educating our people on what they can and can't do. Number one, to empower them, to keep your family safe, to keep you safe, and hopefully to strengthen us together as a community as a whole. Thank you.
Mr. Wooten, what stood out to you?
Richard Mack, if you don't know, is a sheriff that obviously they said was pro-guns. And everybody on the stage is going to say that they support the Second Amendment. I believe everybody on the stage does support the Second Amendment. The problem, I think, with Sheriff Mack is he may have went just a little too far with a lot of stuff that he believes. He believes in no gun control. So does anybody in this room believe that if you think you're a terrorist, you should just be able to walk in and buy a gun and not have a background check? I don't. I believe that we should do background checks for people because you have mentally unstable people that are going to buying guns and committing crimes. I believe you have terrorists that are among us that have come in through our borders for many years, and we cannot just say no gun control. That's just not a thing that we can do anymore. I think that he starts out like a lot of citizens. I believe he starts out tired of the federal government putting their hands in our business with everything that we do. And I do think that most people feel that way. But I think you can't go to the other extreme either. Some of the groups that he's associated with was going to go to Rowan County, Kentucky, not far from where me and my father-in-law deer hunt, to over there to when the lady refused to do the marriage license. And if that sheriff in that county, if that judge would have found them guilty, they were going to go in and keep that sheriff from stopping her from being held in contempt. We can't go the other way either. This guy can't be a part of a committee that's going to travel the country telling other sheriffs what they're going to do either. So I think that he's frustrated. I think a lot of us are frustrated. I say the tax season is upon us. Nobody pays the federal government more than I do in April. So I think it's something that we're all frustrated about, but I don't think that we can go the complete opposite of no gun control either. I think we've got to support the Second Amendment. I would do that as your sheriff. I'm not going to let people come into your county and take guns. I don't believe that's possible. I don't believe it's going to happen anyway. Come in and take.
Thank you. Mr. Sosebee, what stood out to you?
The Supreme Court ruled 5-4 in favor of this. That's our Supreme Court. They believed in this unconstitutional oath. And another thing you need to know about Mr. Mack is some of the people that he follows or he supports, Oath Keepers. He's a right-wing extremist. He was Sheriff Mack from 1988 to 1994, but he's a concern to me. He is somebody that I would watch, somebody I would not say put on a terrorist list or anything like that, but he's somebody I would watch. Would I trust him? That's a question I'd have to read more in depth about, Mr. Mack, as everybody else needs to. But There is a system out there that's in place, ladies and gentlemen, that you have to obtain fingerprints, you have to get fingerprinted, and FBI background checks to obtain a firearms permit. Start in your probate court, then you go down to the sheriff's office to be fingerprinted, or at the GAPS. But it is a process that we have, and we have to follow that. And then hopefully that's gonna keep us secure with the firearm that's out there. You can't stop every firearm that's in here. There's been too many, and we've got way past that. A lot of people out here has got firearms that nobody probably even knows about. I bought firearms when I was 20 years old. I still have them today. You just walked in somebody's house and got them. Just thank you.
Then the last part of the question is with regard to Sheriff Richard Mack's positions. How would this influence any decisions that you make as sheriff, Mr. Perry?
Again, you know, it's just like I said before, I'm a very pro Second Amendment, and like Jeff said also, I believe in the Constitution. I believe it that the first 10 amendments, you know, they're called the Bill of Rights, and they're called that for some reason. You know, our forefathers, when they put that together, they didn't mean it to last in 1776 until that period. They meant it to be everlasting. So as far as how that would influence my decision as sheriff, we can do everything that we can to protect you as citizens here in Georgia that will oppose anything that's unconstitutional. And that's state constitution, that's a federal constitution. We will, however, we will enforce state and federal law. There's a big difference there. If you go in, there's 1,000, I think President Reagan said there's 1,020-something laws, anti-gun laws, on the books right now, federal statutes and state statutes. You know, he said after he got shot, and he said, we don't need no more gun control. We need to enforce the laws we have now. We're going to streamline, we're going to make the process easier for you to come in and get fingerprinted. And so currently a $5 fee, I believe, for the fingerprint process, we're going to waive that. We're also going to offer citizens firearms training to anyone out here who wants to go. The reason I say that is because I come from a background, I'm a post-certified firearms instructor. You know, it's one thing to own a weapon, it's one thing to go get a carrier permit, but it's like driving a car. You need to learn how to use that before you carry it, so we're going to do that.
Mr. Johnson, in regard to Sheriff Mack's positions, would this influence any decisions that you make as sheriff?
Not that on itself. And again, to explain that further, I believe in your Second Amendment wholeheartedly. I will say this, that I think we need to use reason and logic when we do everything. So anytime any federal agents come into the county, obviously we need to have that common courtesy. We need to be able to have that dialogue and that cooperation and that partnership. And if you think, well, the feds can't come, the feds are already here. There's a slew of federal programs that's already in place that you and I are already exposed to and privy to. As your sheriff, I can promise you one thing. I believe that we've overdone it with our laws and our gun laws. And I don't care how many laws you make or how many laws you create, there'll still be those that just don't care, those that's going to circumvent it, period. So the more we create laws and the more we create laws, what are we doing? We're hampering the law-abiding citizen. We've seen it at the rash of the Newport, Connecticut shooting with the permits that were issued. We had just an influx of folks coming in to get their permits. And I jokingly made to one of the folks that was there, and I said, I don't think I've seen the first criminal come in to get their permit. So basically, there's too many laws in place. We're hurting ourselves, we're killing ourselves with these laws. And as your sheriff, I can promise you this, if there's any right infringing laws or potential, whether it's a county ordinance, whether it's a state law, as a sheriff, I promise you, I'll be in their ear. Thank you.
Mr. Wooten, with regard to the Sheriff Mack's position, would this influence any decisions that you make as sheriff?
Yeah, let me clear something up. I said I don't believe that they can come get your guns. I still stick by that. I think if you look, you'll see that the way they're controlling gun control already is through ammo. I think there's ways that they can do this, and I know there's people in the room that can make their own ammo, but for the most part, most of us can't. So I think they're already controlling our firearms through ammo. It's hard to get a lot of times, and that's the reason I think it's just them controlling the ammo. Does his stuff affect me? I think that, you know, at the end of the day, we both, all of us up here, whoever gets this is going to be sworn to uphold state and federal laws, everything that we already have talked about. At the end of the day, though, when you see things like the fact, if somebody tells us we're coming into Dawson County, we're going to take the firearms of the landowners in Dawson County, it will be the place where civil war begins. That's not going to happen in Dawson County. I don't see anybody lined up to give them their guns. I'm not giving my guns up. I can tell you why, because I have three little boys at home and a wife, and the only reason that we've had wars on other people's turf instead of the U.S.'s turf is because we believe in guns in the United States. And they've said before, the reason you don't attack America is there's a gun behind every blade of grass. And we got to keep that here. We got to make sure that stays here. But most importantly for me, I think you got to be willing to walk away. If federal law passes to the point that I get told that I'm going to enforce things that I don't believe that are against my convictions and against the First Amendment, Second Amendment, whichever amendment it is, at some point you have to be willing to say, I'm not going to do this job anymore. This job does not define who I am. I have convictions and ethics that are much higher than being your sheriff, and that's being a Christian first, and that's being somebody that cares about our protection of our safety second, and I'm going to fight for those. That'll be, if I have to stand up and leave, then I'll stand up and leave.
Mr. Sosebee, with regard to Sheriff Mack's positions, would this influence any decisions that you make as sheriff?
Ladies and gentlemen, our founding fathers, with our Constitution and Declaration of Independence, what they wrote in that is we the people. Now, that means something to me. We can say this is, we the citizens are gonna stand together in this county and gonna fight the federal government. But I think if we reach out to those that's in charge at the federal government level and communicate with them, I don't think they'll be coming in here trying to take everybody's guns away. Because if you've got that relationship with people, you can solve a lot of problems. Now, I will not support any style of federal government coming in here taking our guns away. I will not ever support that. September 2015, I wrote a statement on my webpage regarding the Second Amendment and what it means to me. Also, if you'll look with the Georgia Sheriff's Association, they took a stance against this as well. So that's who we work for. Sheriffs, we report to them. They work with us, they help us, they train us. Each one of us, whoever the sheriff's gonna be next, will have to go to academy with the Georgia Sheriff's Association. So that is something that's in my heart, that we will not have our guns taken away from us. I'll stand beside you on that. Thank you.
Question seven is a change of pace from where the type of question we've been asking. It's more of a question about your personal character. Everyone can identify a defining moment in their lives, one that changed their outlook on life in some form or fashion. What would be your defining moment and why? You have a minute and 30 seconds to answer, Mr. Johnson.
Well, that's an easy one. And I'll say this, I know there's supposed to be a separation of church and state, but let me share this with you. As a 7-year-old boy, I surrendered my life to Christ. And it was profound. I knew that I was lost, I knew that I was dying, and I knew that I was going to hell. And as a 7-year-old boy, I surrendered my life to him. Now, for those that know me for a long time, and you can ask my wife, I've been far from perfect. But I'm thankful that I'm forgiven. And that's been the most defining personal event in my life, by far more than anything. There's been some other proud moments that I've had. Obviously, I've married my high school sweetheart, and we had two fine sons. My oldest son is now a pastor in Troy University. I went to Troy University as a pastor, youth student minister at Southside Baptist Church there. Lovely wife, married a Gainesville girl. Got my youngest son back here. I have my sweet mom in the audience with me tonight. So I've been blessed to live in a simple home. I grew up under simple, loving mom and dad, and life was simple, but it sure was sweet. And thank you.
Mr. Wooten.
Like Jeff said, that's an easy question. So obviously when you got saved, you might have been a little luckier than I was to do it at 7 years old. I think that I was one that didn't grow up in church, and I think that helps me a lot, because I grew up as a young adult trying to do it my way, and I found out that that's not easy to do. Your way is just not going to work out. It didn't work out for me. So the best part of my life, obviously, is when I gave my life to Christ and I realized that it's His will. And that's simple for this. I know this is an election. I know people wear different people's shirts. But at the end of the day, I think everybody on the state simply wants what God's will is. If it doesn't come from His hands, I don't want it in mine. I feel that way about the sheriff's race and every single thing that I do in my life. If I have to go work at Ingalls or
I actually like working at Walmart. I probably did a good job. So if that's what I get called to do, that's what I'm going to do. But I, you know, for me, it's easy answer is simple. That it's obviously the day that, you know, Christ came into my life and changed my life. Thank you.
Mr. Sosebee.
Well, I can convey with the gentleman here on that, because I waited till I was 29 years old. And I was sitting at the very back pew, right-hand side of Concord Baptist Church. Jimmy Orr was preaching that morning. And I've been a sinner for 29 years of my life. Am I perfect? No, I'm not. But that day, when my right foot turned and I had to go, it's like somebody just towed me down there and I fell on my face and I accepted Jesus my Lord and Savior. And here I've been tied ever since. And that's a blessing in itself. That's a blessing in itself. But what's a true blessing is one night on 183 over here, we had a bad wreck. I was the first one there. There was a young man that I knew who was from high school. And he was bleeding to death. And I stopped the blood. And he was scared. He was cold. And he asked me. He said, you've been saved. I said, yes, I am. And I led that kid to Christ. Now, that means more to me than anything else there is, beside my precious family. And God, of course. Thank you.
Mr. Perry.
My name is Samer. I would break three moments in my life, young life, 52 years old. One was when I was 13 years old and I accepted the Lord Savior Jesus as my personal Savior. The other one was in 1989 when I married my wife, and that was a great moment. And the third one was the birth of my two children. And all of those, God first, family second. And that's how I led. That's how I lead is my work. You know, I don't have anything in my work that's more important than my faith and my family. And so that's one of my criteria right there. If I'm elected chair and staff there, family will always come first. And I hope that you put God first. One quick thing, I don't know if I have time, but my wife and I got a call where our revival is going on in our church, so I got a call yesterday that, Jeff, you need to be the song leader, the assistant song leader, and the song leader wasn't going to be there. So I said, great. And so Lisa came home, she said, you know, I got to play the piano. And I said, well, you do great. You play the organ every Sunday, and you know how to play the piano. I said, I can't sing a lick. And she thought for a moment, she said, yeah, you're right. When you get up there, just move your lips so nobody can hear you. So I love her, and I'm glad I didn't sing her advice tonight, because last night my confidence was way down here. But I love you, and I appreciate what you mean to have been in my life.
Question number 8. This will be 2 minutes. As sheriff, you will be in a position of leadership. Leadership is characterized by a display of emotional intelligence, integrity, vision, and a motivation that creates an environment of personal influence. In your new job as sheriff, how will you successfully demonstrate these personal traits to be viewed as a leader that the department will follow? Mr. Wooten.
Is that being a leader is obviously, you know, the first thing for me that pops in is being willing to be out there with the people that work for you and be able to see. You've got to lead by example. I don't believe that you can lead from the bottom up. I believe you have to lead from top down. That person that accepts this role, whatever the citizens vote for, you got to be able to lead this community and this sheriff's office. You know, I believe that, you know, when I was over patrol in CID, one of the things that I think that I did well was I got involved. There was many nights. Going back to 1 year at New Year's Eve, I answered the first call tonight. Me and my partner turned out to be a guy that barricaded himself and took his own life. I was the major. I didn't have to be out there, but you have to be out there. I may not be, as your sheriff, I'm not going to be sitting behind a desk. That's just not who I am. You've seen me at ball games. You've seen me at park stuff. You've seen me. I think you lead by being an example. I think you lead by being involved. I think you lead by helping the troops when they need help. I work patrol as a captain, a major. When we were short, I went out there and worked. And you have to roll up your sleeves. Everybody has to get their hands dirty. You can't just simply say we're going to go ask the commission for more and more and more. Sometimes you're going to have to get your hands dirty, and you're going to have to go out there and help. And that involves everybody at the sheriff's office, not just the people that are out there, not just the 5 that are on patrol, but everybody in the sheriff's office. I think leadership means that. I think you've heard people that continuously say that, you know, they believe this or they believe that. Three of the four of us on the stage have a take-home car from the county sheriff's office. If you believe so much about stopping it, turn the ignition and go help. We all have a car. We can get involved in this. That's what I think you look for, somebody that's willing to go get out there and get involved, not somebody that just talks about what they're going to do. We hear too much of that going on now with politics. Promises, promises, promises. I think we should look at what people have done in the past, see the results they've gotten. I love that we keep talking about crime reduction because that's what we've already done. So I feel like it's a pat on the back. And hopefully those who are going to view this tonight see that everything's going pretty well in Dawson County considering that crime's dropping like crazy. And everybody says that's the most important thing. So I thank you. I ask for your vote on May 24th. Thank you.
Mr. Sosebee?
Ladies and gentlemen, it is leadership. It's going in there, working with these ladies and gentlemen, I mean, these young men and women, side by side, working on patrol, working in the CID, working on the courts, working in the detention, now the Georgia Department of Corrections. You do have to get in the trenches with these men and women. You have to work side by side with them. You got to show that you care. If you don't show you don't, if you don't care about their future, about their lives, about their family, they're going to leave and find somebody that does care. I think you want a sheriff that's going to lead by those examples. That's going to be out here in the community talking one-on-one with you. I believe in town hall meetings. I believe in bringing everybody together. Let's put everything out on the table. Let's talk about what's going on in this county. I want to hear your concerns. I want to hear your ideas. You may have a better idea than any of us. I'm open to that. We're not going to squash anything. But it's truly working with these men and women, showing that you're in there with them, sitting in a control room with somebody down at the jail, riding on night shift, not day shift, night shift with a patrol officer, walking into a home with an officer. Well, there's the sheriff. That will mean something to people. If you'll let me as your sheriff, that's what you're going to get. You'll get everything I got. Thank you.
Mr. Perry?
Leadership is more than just words. It's one's character. It's one's integrity. It's one's ability to inspire others to do great things. Ronald Reagan said, you know, a leader's not the one that does the greatest things. He's the one that gets the people to do the greatest things. That's what leadership is. Being able to listen and still talk is a point that I always used, had it up on my wall. You know, there's a wise old bird. The more he spoke, the less he heard. Ranking would be like this wise old bird. The other thing was every day, every point when we had an office, I would go in. First hour, 45 minutes to hour, and you may say, well, boy, that's wasting state time. I mean, state money. I would go in, I would meet with each person. And we wouldn't talk about the business of the day or what we're going to do tomorrow. We asked about each other's family. We asked about the children. And we asked what kind of problems they had. So that 8 years later, when they have a kid graduate, you know, you're asking about that. That's leadership. Leadership is being able to see that you may not know the answer, but you will get the answer. Leadership is taking the step to do the best and showing the character and integrity. And I ask this question. You know, Sheriff Carlisle has been in office for 20 years. We owe him a great debt of thanks because he took that department to where it was it is now. That's leadership. And regardless what you may think, you know, anybody that's been in office for 20 years deserves our thanks. And so the other thing that I would say is that we have to be able to listen. As a leader, you have to be able to listen to your people. Find out what their needs are. Find out, you know, that they're working more hours than they can make it. They're not making, they have to work two jobs because they're not being paid enough here in Dawson County. They have to take a job in the private sector because they love law enforcement. They love working in Dawson County, but they're not being paid.
Mr. Johnson. Ladies and gentlemen, the greatest resource that we have in Dawson County across the board, whether it's sheriff, whether it's fire, whether it's public works, utilities, is our people. And how do we inspire, how do we lead? Ladies and gentlemen, again, I don't want to echo what the other candidates have said, but obviously we need to lead by example. We need to be there, we need to be mentors for our people. We need to help guide them, lead them, direct them. You know, we can sit up here and say we've got the experience, we've got that experience. And ladies and gentlemen, I've devoted my life, my entire professional life, to law enforcement. Been in the trenches. I don't hold a title. A title is useless without is a title without substance is fruitless. And a title to me, doesn't mean a whole lot. Ladies and gentlemen, I've been there with men and women. We'll continue to be so. We've got to inspire our people. We've got to encourage our people. We've got to take more care of our people than we do our cars, than we do of our building, than we do of our other facilities. We can have the finest cars, we can have the finest facility, but if we don't have the quality men and women to staff those, to put out there. And ladies and gentlemen, I don't think you're real concerned whether it's a 2016 Dodge that pulls up in your driveway or whether it's a 2010 Dodge that pulls up in your driveway. But where your concern is and where my concern is from your, as your sheriff, will be how do they treat you? Are they properly trained? Are they adequately trained to help you with your time of need? Because ladies and gentlemen, when you call 911, you don't get your choice of who's coming out. You want to get a representative of the sheriff. So as you make your decision, I encourage you, who do you want coming out? What kind of representation do you want coming out? And ladies and gentlemen, I know this to be true, and I was told this from an old cop years ago. A shift will always be a reflection of its supervisor. A department will always be a reflection of its department head. And your sheriff's office will always be a reflection of your sheriff. So as you go to the polls and you think about that, who do I want coming out to assist me and helping me in my time of need? Thank you.
Okay, our last question kind of takes us from the objective to the subject. And we're going to hear the bottom line from each of you. The question is simply, why do you want to be sheriff of Dawson County? You have 2 minutes to respond. Mr. Sosebee.
Ladies and gentlemen, like I said, I've got 32 years of law enforcement experience. This is my life. This is what I've done all my life. There have been times when I was on patrol back in the day, riding on a Sunday evening, and you pull into somebody's house. Not only just to pull in, but you got to eat dinner with them. We've got away from all that. People don't know who people are anymore. You don't even know who your neighbors are anymore. We've got about what family really is. Back when we go to Christmas, you know, it's your families were there. It meant something. The love. But the county here is growing, ladies and gentlemen. It's expanding rapidly. And your sheriff's office has got to be prepared to meet these challenges. These times are coming that we're going to have to stand firm and walk hand in hand, side by side, not front and back, front and back. But we're going to have to lead and help these young officers and show how we can develop and carry this county into the future. The future is coming here, ladies and gentlemen. It's setting on 400 right now. We're seeing the essence of it now. We got to prepare ourselves for it. All the training that I've had, that I've went to, it's meant something to me. I didn't take this training just to set it on a table or put it under the rug or file a little certificate in a box somewhere. I took this to stand here before you tonight and ask you for your vote and confidence in me to be your sheriff. I am prepared for this. Thank y'all.
Mr. Perry.
I want to make a difference in someone's life. I want to make a difference in your life. If you look back with the decks, this is going to be a sight of times for people in Dawson County. You know, the economic downturn is gone. We're seeing an economic upturn for change. We're seeing economic growth, but not everything that comes with growth is good. We have to take the bad with the good and everything. I want to be able to put a great product out here and great customer service. And you look at, you know, which is more important, customer service or the product? Well, both. Because if you got a great product and you have poor customer service, and nobody's going to buy your product. If you got a great customer service and a poor product, then nobody's going to buy your product. So we want to represent Dawson County Sheriff's Department. So when you see anything about Dawson County Sheriff, you'll be proud that Sheriff's Department, I'm from Dawson County. Also,
you know, I told you, I come with experience. I made the tough decisions, managing a budget in 2008. Now, you go back to 2008, that was a terrible time. We all had to make tough decisions. But every decision you make when you manage a budget has an impact on someone's life, whether you as the external customers or someone employees as an internal customer. You can't make decision based on what's best for one group or one person. You have to make what a decision best on the whole group. We're facing furloughs and layoffs. We closed three offices, returned $2 million back to the state budget general fund. Not one employee of mine took a furlough day. Not one employee of mine laid off. And so that's the kind of management we need, the leadership, the ability to manage a budget, to set strategic planning and direct operations. And I have that experience, and I hope you vote for me and let me your share on May 24th, 2020.
Mr. Johnson.
Thank you. Why do I want to serve as sheriff? The answer is simple, it's a commitment to serve. Ladies and gentlemen, I've ran on the campaign the slogan, your office, your sheriff. I truly believe that from the bottom of my heart. I'm not seeking a title. I'm not seeking power. I'm not seeking notoriety. I could care less about that. We've dedicated our career to law enforcement, to trying to make a difference in the lives of others. As the sheriff, working as the sheriff's major, we've never faltered. We've never abandoned our position. We've never given it up. We've always stayed the course. We've endured a lot of difficult times. And I promise you that, we've enjoyed a lot of rewarding times. We've enjoyed a lot of successes. Ladies and gentlemen, there's more to do. There's a lot of work to be done. And I think the key to that is building partnerships with each of you. And regardless of whose shirt you're wearing today, who you're supporting, I can promise you this. If I get elected your sheriff, I'll treat you with the same optimal service that I will with these men and women supporting me out here today. Ladies and gentlemen, this is about service. This is not about anybody up here, but this is about our community. This is about our county. I grow tired and I grow weary of elected leaders holding positions and just to hold positions. You know, whether it's power some people want, whether it's money, whether it's retirement, whatever the case may be, I grow weary of it. And I don't make promises for fear that I may not be able to keep promises. But I make a pledge to you that as your sheriff, I'll be an involved sheriff. I'll be a working sheriff. And you have that commitment from me. It's about the people. It's not about me. It's about the people. Thank you very much.
Mr. Wooten. Service. It's easy. Servant leadership. That's the only kind of leadership I believe that there is, servant leadership. You know, servant leadership is not an 8-to-5 job. You don't go home at 5 o'clock. Most people that are in this room, I said in the last debate too, so you've seen me out and about. 18 years in Dawson County, fixing to start my 19th year. I've been a part of many, many programs that have gotten started in Dawson County. I've ran those programs in Dawson County. But it's more than just an 8-to-5 job. I remember a kid that I was thinking about today over the years because, you know, I mean, unfortunately, when some of us may lose this, we may not be here anymore. So this may be all for a couple of us on the stage tonight. Maybe my last chance to tell you how much I appreciate working for Dawson County. But I was reflecting today on the things that I remember about the things that I'm thankful for the sheriff's office. I remember the two kids that lost their moms in the same year. Two different kids, both lost their moms. And me and another officer took them to Turner Field, and we paid for everything that day to give those kids an opportunity to do something they weren't get to do in a year that's been tough. When we get ready to shop with a cop, when Walmart came, I was knocking on the door before they got the building up, wanting to shop with a cop here to take care of the kids that are in need during Christmas time. I started programs through our church to feed kids that are hungry. That when people talked about, oh, our kids are eating out of the trash can, I did something about it. I didn't stand and talk about, yes, we should do more. I went out and figured out a way. When we do a Christmas project every year at our church, third year in a row we did, and it's grown tremendously. This year we had to go out. Thank God Birds helped us at the mini storage. We had to get a U-Haul for all the toys we took out on Christmas Day. We partnered with other churches. That's servant leadership. It's not the talk. I'm so sick of hearing people tell you what they're going to do if they get something. Why haven't you been doing that already? That's servant leadership. You shouldn't have to wait until you can come into a room and say, guys, if you elect me, I will do this. You should be able to look at that product and say, have you already been doing this? And to me, I believe that I have. We've been doing instrumental stuff with kids and citizens forever in Dawson County. I can tell you I've got a letter from a lady not long ago when her husband died in a car accident. She lost her unborn child. I threw a basketball tournament at Dawson County High School with surrounding counties, and we were able to raise money for her needs. That's servant leadership.
Thank you.
We now come to the closing remarks. We're going to take the candidates in reverse order from the opening remarks. Each of you will now have 3 minutes to summarize what you have said tonight or provide any other closing remarks that you might have. 3 minutes, and we will start with Mr. Wooten.
I get to go first for a change. The last names, feel good about this. The, you know, for me, it's simple. I go back to, I've said it a million times, and I'm going to keep saying it. It's been my passion. I believe that you need to look for somebody that's passionate as your sheriff. I don't believe you're going to look on the stage and find anybody that's bad. Nobody here is somebody that's not going to be able to hold this position if you elect them. I think all of us are going to get everything that we have. I think it's simple. It's who do you think is best that cares most about the community? I believe that's me. I believe I've shown that for the 18 years. It's not just that I have the heart, it's that I have the experience that goes with that heart. I've been the commander of every division but one. I worked that division when I first started out. I've been everything that you can possibly be in the sheriff's office to make sure that I'm prepared for this. I've moved around different positions to get the experience that I need, that if I choose to do this one day, that I'd be ready to be your sheriff. I feel like the day that I walk in the sheriff's office that I am prepared to take over that. I've ran patrols. You know, one of the endorsements I got lately that means the most to me, my wife can tell you, I actually started crying when this lady sent it to me. 7 days we searched for these two kids a few years ago. You'll probably remember that. 7 days. I was the patrol division commander, the investigations commander, the public information officer. I met with the family daily, made sure that us and the GBI worked together every day to make sure that we worked together and got along, which is a challenge sometimes, to make sure everything that went well for that. But when this mom sent me an endorsement letter saying, you are the right one for the job, that didn't turn out well. That, like, we found that lady in the lake. But for 7 days, relentlessly, I worked that case. I was the first face she saw every morning. I was the last face in the sheriff's office she saw every night. That's the commitment that I believe that you need as your sheriff. It's not an 8-to-5 job. I come in, we're having a revival of our church. I couldn't even stay there because I know this lady's lost her kid. Her kid is lost right now. She doesn't have an answer for where her kid is. Both moms, both dads don't know where their kids is. I can't just go home and say, what's on TV? I'm not that kind of person. I'm the person that's going to go out. We're going to turn over every stone that we can, and we're going to find ways to be able to prove and give those answers that we need to those people. And I think that's the experience that you need. You need somebody that can say that they've led those kind of things, that they've been in charge of investigations, that they've been in charge of patrol. You can't just simply say, I've done that. We've got new people right now today that just started. They've done that. They're not ready to be your sheriff. You can't just simply say, I've done that. I think the most important thing is to say, I've led that. I've already shown the success. You heard on the stage today, everybody's talking about crime reduction. I appreciate that. Like I said before, we have reduced crime. You heard people talk about gangs. And I'm going to tell you, one of the persons sitting here can attest to this is Johnny Holzclaw. We've had kids that come into our school system that tried to start gangs in Dawson County. We ran them out of Dawson County. That's why you don't have gangs, because we've been doing stuff. Not because we've been sitting around talking about what's going to happen, because we got after it then, and we'll continue to get after it if I'm elected sheriff. Thank you.
Mr. Johnson.
Ladies and gentlemen, your sheriff is tasked with providing certain duties and responsibilities. And there's a Georgia code that lays them out. It's running a jail. It's running civil processes and serving civil processes. It's in jurisdictions such as ours that are smaller. It's about providing patrol enforcement services. Ladies and gentlemen, and I wouldn't say anything bad about a community program because I'm involved in a lot of them. Ladies and gentlemen, you're electing a sheriff. You're electing someone to enforce the laws of this county, to treat people right, to treat people fair, to treat people with respect and dignity. Ladies and gentlemen, the liability is far too great for us to risk. And what I mean by that is simply this. In today's society, it's a very litigious society. And as law enforcement officers, we have certain duties that we execute. Anytime we put our hands on someone, we have seized them in the eyes of the court. We have to justify that seizure. And that means that hopefully we're mature, hopefully we're making good decisions, hopefully we're making them with probable cause, hopefully we're making them in accordance with state law, with case law, such as that. Ladies and gentlemen, you're tasked with finding a sheriff, someone to lead your department for the next 4 years. I'm all about community programs. I believe them, I support them. But there's a bigger picture at play here. This is law enforcement that affects the entire county as a whole. And ladies and gentlemen, I submit to you, I don't claim to know it all, and the day that I do know it all, it's time for me to go. It's time for me to step aside and let somebody else have the reins. But I've been fortunate. We have progressed. I've spent my entire career in a patrol capacity, in a supervisory capacity, serving, commanding investigations, patrol, specialized multi-agency task force, things of that nature. I've spent my career as a teacher, as an instructor. I've spent time trying to teach and educate and help. You've all heard the saying that the best teacher in life, or the best experience, the best teacher in life is experience, and I believe that. Ladies and gentlemen, life's a hard teacher sometimes, but thankfully that we've learned from them, that we've been able to apply them. Ladies and gentlemen, you're going to elect a sheriff, and this sheriff has got to be a representation of the people. He's got to be a representative of the people, and he's got to make the wise decisions to keep us out of liability, to keep us from getting exposed to liability. Ladies and gentlemen, I pledge to you this. I ask for your vote. I ask for call me. If you have questions, if you have concerns, my education, my training is all an open book, and I'll be glad to share it with you. But I ask for your prayers, and I ask for your vote on May the 24th. Thank you.
Mr. Perry.
Thank you. First, I want to thank you for coming out here tonight. It's very important to be informed. I want to thank the Dawson County Republican Party, Tea Party, and the Foothills Women Program for putting this on tonight so that you could learn about each candidate up here. I'll begin by saying this right here in my closing remarks. My father, my Aunt Sharon's here, my father's sister. My daddy, he had a limited education, but he was a hard worker. He was still driving a truck when he was 78 years old when he died. He had three things that he told me that I remember to this day and everything. He was, treat people the way you want to be treated. The second thing was, if you go to work for, do a dollar's worth of work, then you give that man a dollar's worth of work. And the third thing was, never quit learning. I was the first person in my family to ever complete college. And after that, you're talking about the leadership role. When you have cousins and other cousins see you do it, then they know you can do it. I brought that same thing to the work as a leadership for the state of Georgia for 30 years. I had the highest retention rate when I retired, and I also practiced what was called results-based budgeting, meaning that if we were funding something and it wasn't getting results, then we had what we would set as our meter. If we didn't reach that goal, then we weren't going to fund that program again. Now, I said this before, I said this countless times. The way government used to be, we cannot function no longer. We saw that in 2008. We had to be smarter with the money. We had to be innovative. We had to think outside the box. And that's why I told you, we closed two or three offices that was under me. We sent people home to work from their homes and their vehicles. And you had technology to do it. And that right there, that saved $2 million that we returned to the general fund, which was your dollars, and not one employee again face a furlough or was laid off a day. And then you look, I go back and look, when I retired, I said I had highest retention. When I retired, I had four of my people retire with me. And the other chiefs throughout the state would come up where you had a high turnover rate, and they wanted to know what we were doing. And the thing was, it goes back to those three principles that I just discussed with you that my dad told me. Treat people the way you want to be treated. When you get paid for a dollar's worth of work, then you give that man a dollar's worth of work, and never quit learning. So as your sheriff, I hope you elect me on May 24th, because we do. You have to know who you want to be the face of Dawson County Sheriff's Department in the next 4 years. If you have a crisis here, who do you want leading that? Someone with experience who's led on a national level with the state limits in 96, and also the G8 summit. And you want to see something that will try your leadership skills. I was the leader of Atlanta Police Department
very much.
When I was down there. Thank you.
Mr. Sosebee.
Ladies, Dillon, I'm asking up front for your prayers and your support and your vote for your next sheriff. And the reason I'm asking you for that is my experience of leadership working with these officers hand in hand, side by side. I know what it's like to be in a control room and nobody ever comes and checks on you during the day. I know what it's like when the sheriff doesn't walk down and greet you or hasn't been down there in 6 months, down in the booking, or riding out on patrol with you. I know what that's like. You got to have somebody that cares, and I care. I care for every officer in this department up here, every officer. Now, when I come in as sheriff, what my vision is I'm going to put a school resource officer in every school. We don't have that right now. I don't know if anybody knows that. That's first. Our children being protected is top priority to me and our teachers. Secondly, we're going to work on the drugs in this county. I'm going to join force with Sheriff Gerald Couch. We're going to bring some money back into this county. We're going to work on a criminal apprehension unit, suppression unit, to deter crime in this county, because we're going to be faced with it. Over the next 5 to 10 years, we're going to see a growth in this county like we've never seen before, unless somehow our government can slow it down. A sheriff's going to have to be somebody that's going to have to be able to go in a commission room and sit down with them as a friend, not a foe, and actually work together side by side, hand to hand. I believe in that strongly. And work on a budget for this county. Not asking everybody for tax dollars. Not asking everybody to, you know, give everything you got till you bleed. We're not going to do that. That's not what I'm about. We're going to reorganize this department, like I said before. With that reorganization, we're going to be able to put funding back into these officers' pocket. So that need cost the U.S. taxpayers. If anybody would like to see that, please call me. I'll be happy to sit down with anybody in here that would like to see that. I can show you how it can be done. I've worked on this for the last 4 years, and it can be done. It's just reorganizing this department. And it's going to put more people out on the streets, which we're going to need, and no cost to U.S. taxpayers. You've got my word on that. I'm going to be working, like I said, with y'all, our taxpayers. I'm going to be visiting you. If you get tired of seeing this big old face coming or driving up your driveway or somebody coming in there to see you, it's going to be me. I believe in that. I totally believe in that. My grandpa, my daddy, all of them taught me from a young, very young age. When I was helping them plowing a field up there, trying to raise watermelons, selling produce up there, I know what it's like to get my hands dirty and my feet dirty because I didn't wear shoes back then. So, nothing like having a little red clay, but I wish you both one. Thank you.
I'd like to now introduce Ms. Sharon Keating.
Wow, that was fantastic. Let's give our candidates a big hand. Thank you very much for taking your time to come out and inform us. We really, really appreciate it. And as it was expressed numerous times, the best voter is an informed voter. And I believe personally this is a particularly important election as going forward. We could quite possibly, our sheriff could be making decisions that have not been an issue in the past that have been brought out in some of the discussion. And I urge each and every one of you to get to know these gentlemen over the next few weeks. If you have unanswered questions, please contact them personally. I was going to do a card with all their email addresses, and I forgot, so I apologize. But please talk to them and get their email addresses and their telephone numbers, because I know they would really, really like to speak with you. Thank you to Dawson County Middle School for the use of the building. This is absolutely a beautiful venue, and it worked out quite well, except I'm sure they're all really hot by now. I would also like to thank everyone behind the scenes who helped us out to make this possible and to have it go so smoothly and well organized. A couple of announcements. There is in the works plans for a meet and greet for all the candidates running for public office on April 26th. That's the date that's been saved, and that would be here at the middle school again, but we don't have all the details yet, and it would also be a joint venture with the three groups that did this tonight. And so just watch for that announcement and all the details. The next Tea Party meeting is April 12th, the second Tuesday, at the community room at Fire Station Number 2. The next Dawson County GOP meeting is April 19th at the Bowen Arts Center, and they will not have a meeting in May. The next Foothill Republican Women's Club event is going to be the the joint event with on April 26th, the meet and greet. And then we will have a meeting at least in June. And so if you're on our email list, please watch your email, and we'll have information about that, because you know it will be candidate related, I'm sure. If you are not registered to vote, there is still time. You do need to be registered by April 26th. And Glenda Ferguson was so kind as to bring voter registration cards, and they are at the table out in the hallway. She also brought a sample ballot. Yes, I'm very excited about that. Early voting starts May 2nd and goes through May 20th from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. And there's one Saturday day you can vote, and that's May 14th from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. The election is May 24th from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. And the runoff is July 26th. And now we need to leave the building, so please take your conversations outside, because we are on a time limit. And have a safe drive home, and we look forward to seeing you again. Thank you.
Yeah.